Welcome back to the Center for Performing Arts at Rhinebeck. This is January. We have survived the Mayan apocalypse, the Aztec two-step, and the Toltec delirium tremens. And that means, moving logically along, this is Wild West Month at the Center for Performing Arts. The month of January is Wild West Month. And how do I know that? Because we're in front of our stable here at the Center for Performing Arts. Also, on this little table in front of me, I have alcohol, tobacco, and firearms. So this must be Wild West Month. It's all right. Don't worry about it. Slightly more than half of our actors are out in the North 40. They are riding, roping, and branding. Sounds like date night in Rhinebeck. But with me, I have the stars of our big Wild West show and the director of our big Wild West show, Annie, get your gun. And sitting to my left is Wild Bill Kate Olson. And immediately to my right is Wild Bill Andy Weintraub. And over here on the right is Wild Bill Dean Temple. Why is everybody Bill in the West? Does everybody know? Do you know why? I mean, Buffalo Bill, Cody, Wild Bill Hickok, Billy the Kid. Weren't there any Maurices or Sydneys in the Wild West? Just Bills. But anyway, I'm very excited. Wild West Month, and I've talked enough. So we're going to talk to the star of Annie, Get Your Gun. This is Wild Bill Kate Olson. This is one of my favorite shows, ladies and gentlemen. This is all about this little orphan girl, and her name is Annie. She lives in an orphanage, and she, what? No?
You got the wrong show.
I have the wrong show.
You have the wrong
this
show.
This is not that Annie.
It's Annie, Get Your Gun.
Annie, Get Your
not
Gun.
Annie, Get Your Dog.
Annie, Get Your what? Dog. Sandy the Dog. Well, I thought Sandy was like a steer in this show. Sandy the Steer.
No.
So this is not that show about the little orphan girl?
No, it's not about little orphan Annie.
So what Annie are you in this show?
Annie Oakley.
Annie Oakley. And for those of us who don't know, which would be me, who is that?
She was a famous sharpshooter in the Wild West shows in
Buffalo Bill Cody's.
Buffalo Bill.
Yes. Wild Bill Hickok was a famous shooter.
Wild Bill Ivan Prey.
See, Wild Bill's. This is Buffalo Bill Cody's Wild West show. And there was another guy named Pawnee Bill. There's another Bill. And he had a Wild West show. So, and this is all about alcohol, tobacco, and firearms. So you play Annie Oakley in this show. And Annie Oakley is a sharpshooter.
Yes.
And that's it? That's all she does?
Well, it's also a love story between her and Frank Butler.
Frank Butler, and that's?
Not quite as good a sharpshooter.
He's not as good a sharpshooter?
I'm thinking about letting her win in this show, but I actually haven't decided yet.
Oh, so you two are like competitors?
We are competitors.
Oh, but you're both in the same show.
We are. We're competing for the same part in the show.
The same, you mean the same part? Like, you want to play Annie in this show?
I thought I'd be a good Annie.
You might. So let me get this straight. So you're playing Frank Butler.
I am playing Frank Butler.
And he's the star of Buffalo Bill's Wild West show.
He is Bill's trick shooter star.
And he has top villain.
He has top villain and the biggest poster.
Biggest poster. And then you
tell the bigger, my bigger poster.
You have a bigger poster eventually.
Yes.
All right, so you come along and then you become the best sharpshooter. Well, that sounds like trouble right there.
I'd say she becomes the sharpshooter with the bigger poster.
The sharpshooter with the biggest poster. So in this show, you become the big star, and you gradually fall in love with Frank Butler.
Because
who wouldn't? And so, well, I don't know who wouldn't. So what are the big songs in this show? The Sun Will Come Out Tomorrow is a big show, a song.
Again, that's still Little Orphan-y. You're thinking.
We did that show, didn't we?
Last year.
Were you in that show?
I did the set for it.
You did the set for it, but you weren't performing in it.
No.
So the last thing you performed in was what, Kate?
Here, the last thing I performed in was Gentlemen Prefer Blondes last year.
That was
a year and a half
last
ago.
And Dean, you were also in that.
I was also in that.
Yeah, and I was in that too.
And you were?
Yeah.
That's right, actually. You were in that.
Again, as I've said in all the previous shows, ladies and gentlemen, there are only 9 people who work here. Here are 4 of the 9. Another 4 of the 3 of the 9 will come back later. So tell me, what are these big songs that you sing in this show?
Oh, we do Anything You Can Do, You Can't Get a Man with a Gun, They Say It's Wonderful.
In New York, you can. You can get a man with a gun. You can get anything with a gun in New York. So You Can't Get a Man with a Gun, what
there's
else?
There's No Business Like Show Business.
Which is a big song.
That's a big
song. That's actually the title song for this particular show, Live at the Center.
Oh, really?
Yes. What else?
Oh, let's see. Moonshine Lullaby. That's
she has her alcohol.
Let's see. What else is there? I got the sun in the morning.
Big song. Big song. So this is the director and also the producer. And he is also the founder of the Center for Performing Arts and the president of the board. When I said that nine people do everything, he accounts for five of the nine people. So, Andy, why did you pick this show?
Apparently, this show, in surveys of our audience, was number one on shows that they would like to see here at the center. On top of that, though, and more important, it's just a fabulous musical show. The songs are songs that everybody will walk out of here humming, not questioning.
And their songs,
they probably already know them.
Yeah, they people. And this is written by whom? Who wrote the
Irving music? Berlin.
Wild Bill.
Wild Bill
Irving.
Berlin.
That's right. And Dean, what songs do you sing in this show? Do you
really this one? Well, I start off with There's No Business Like Show Business.
So you introduced that song.
I introduced that song at the beginning of the show.
Yeah.
Completely a cappella.
Uh-huh. A cappella, what does that mean?
That means
that's
I'm singing
like an Italian
by
dish.
Myself. It is.
Oh!
It's by myself with noodles and tomato.
So you sing that song. What else do you sing?
I sing My Defenses Are Down.
Yes.
I sing The Girl That I Married.
Yes.
With Kate over there, I sing They Say It's Wonderful. And we sing Old Fashioned Wedding. And we have our little standoff with Anything You Can Do.
And it means standoff. You're going to do that song later, I think.
We will do that.
We're actually going to do that song live here on our show. So, ladies and gentlemen, here you go. This is our this is the tail end of our seasonal brochure. So what we've got coming up in January is Wake and Sing, which we're going to talk about later, another Wild West show, Wild West Bronx show. Then we have The Elephant Man, which is another Wild West show, Wild West in London. And then we have Annie Get Your Gun, ending the month of January. And, of course, this is our brochure. It's got everything on it. The new one is coming out. Kevin Archambault, who's going to be on the show later, is actually sitting out in the audience. When does the new brochure come out, Kevin?
January 10th.
January 10th, just in time for Wild West Month. We're going to have a new Wild West brochure. It's going to have all our good shows in it. You can call for reservations to come to see a show at the center any Tuesday through Saturday between the hours of 1 p.m. and 5 p.m. And you call 845-876-3080. Wild Bill Eileen Contrini will be on the phone. She'll take your reservation. Or you can get tickets online, www.centerforperformingarts.org. Okay, so we're going to come back to this later.
What does WWW stand for?
Wild West Web. Wild West website. So, Andy, tell me more about this. So you say this is the most popular show that people actually requested this show.
That's what you told me.
That's what I told you. Hoisted on my own Wild West petard, as they say. No, actually, people did request this show quite a bit. We asked them, last year when we were doing Gentlemen Prefer Blondes, we were out in the lobby a couple of us, and at the top of the show, we wheel all this luggage out onto the stage. Kate was sitting on top of, 10,000 trunks, and she had a song called What a Boat, right? Remember that? So she, rocked the house with this song. So I was sitting out there with Richard Prowse one night, and we both looked at each other at the same time, and we said, she sounds like Merman. So we got to do Annie Get Your Gun. And then we did a little research and we found out that's the show that everybody wanted to see. And we talked about it a couple of times in years past. So Andy, this is not the first thing that you were directing here at the center. You've directed other things.
I have.
And what would those things be?
Oh, I directed Carousel back in early 2000, 2001.
Uh-huh.
I directed Inherit the Wind.
Right.
I directed Over the Cuckoo's Nest.
And you were in that.
Yes. And they painted the set.
Yeah.
Yes,
and
you painted.
We were both in that. Again, and nine people do everything. So One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest. But you've done other big musicals. You did Camelot.
I did Camelot. That's right.
You just finished Three Penny Opera.
We just finished Three Penny Opera. Mm-hmm. I didn't direct that. And we before the center was open, I used to direct a lot over at the Morton Library with RTS.
The Rhinebeck Theater Society.
Rhinebeck Theater Society.
Which you founded.
Which I founded.
Back in what? What
back
year was
in
that?
1987.
1987? Kate wasn't even born yet.
I was
yet.
One.
You were one?
Yeah.
In 1987? So you founded the Rhinebeck Theater Society back in 1987.
Actually, it was 86.
86?
Yes.
So why did you do that? I mean, had you lived in Rhinebeck prior to that time?
I moved to Rhinebeck in 1982.
Right.
And I moved from a place, Allentown, Pennsylvania, which was loaded with community theater and lots of opportunities. And when I came to Rhinebeck, there was nothing in Rhinebeck. In order to participate, I had to go to Kingston or Poughkeepsie. And so...
And in those days, we didn't have paved roads.
That's right.
In 87. So getting to Kingston...
We just had horses.
You had to swim the Hudson.
It was a little
countdown. Show. Yeah. So you saw that there was no community theater here at all.
There was a need.
And there was a need for that.
Yes. So we put out a few of us got together and formed the Rhinebeck Theater Society. And we decided the first production was going to be A Man Who Came to Dinner.
The Man Who Came to Dinner.
Yes, starring Bib Chandler.
Who is no longer with us. Yes,
and,
Bronson Chandler.
And we had a terrific turnout and a great show. We did it in the Rhinebeck Town Hall.
Mm-hmm.
And they told us after that was over, get out of here, don't ever come back.
Was that the first and only time you were there?
That was the first and only time we were in the Rhinebeck Town Hall. They have a sign up now saying no theatricals.
In the Rhinebeck Town Hall?
No theatricals allowed.
What'd you do?
We did Man Who Came to
Dinner.
Yeah, but
what we did was
we built a set.
Oh, I see. But people notoriously throughout the ages have not liked actors very well.
That's right.
Keeping informed.
Consistent,
easy to understand.
So, Dean, let me ask you. You came to us when? How many years ago? Like 5 years ago?
This, I think, is my third year.
Third year.
Involved with this theater.
Yes. And what other shows have you done?
Well, I started off here at Jesus Christ Superstar.
Were you Jesus?
I was not Jesus. Oh. I was ensemble back then.
Ensemble?
I was ensemble.
Was he one of the apostles?
He was.
Yep.
He was.
Saint Ensemble.
He was one of the lesser known apostles.
Yeah.
The apostle of quality footwear.
Quality footwear. Oh, yes. And so you did that show.
And so I did that show. And then I was in My Fair Lady with you.
Right. Were you in that? Yeah, you directed that.
No.
You produced that.
I built the set.
You built the set for that.
Right.
All right, so you did My Fair Lady and then.
My Fair Lady. And then the next show I did here was Bye Bye Birdie.
Bye Bye Birdie. Oh, you had a starring role.
That was my first leading role here.
Yes.
I was Albert Peterson.
Albert Peterson.
And that was a really fun part.
Yeah, Dick Van Dyke played that on Broadway.
Exactly.
Yeah, wow, those are big shoes to fill.
They were, well, size 11, I believe.
So that's why you are now a devotee of Saint Ensemble.
That's why I now wear size 11.
Size 11. And what else? And
then I was actually in your production of Robin Hood, which was great fun because I got to learn how to use a broadsword.
Broadsword. That was also a Wild West show.
That was a
Wild West
show.
Nottingham.
It was?
Yes.
Wild West show.
Yeah.
I got to beat up girls with swords.
Well, what more can
anyone do? Unlike many of the shows I've been in.
That's what showbiz is all about.
Yeah.
So here we go. Once again, you can, we've got a lot of these here. We will mail these to you. We have about 115 million people on our mailing list. This goes to places like Dubai and Prague and all over the Far East. And what big holiday do we have coming up? Oh, Valentine's Day. So you can buy these, or you can get these, you can give them to your loved one. You can wrap diamonds and pearls in this. The new one comes out January 10th, just in time for Wild West Month. Again, in this January of 2013, can you believe?
No.
It just seems like it was 1947, just like a few minutes ago. Awake and Sing is coming up in the beginning of January, followed by The Elephant Man. And we're going to have the director of The Elephant Man on later. And we're going to have the assistant director and one of the stars of Awake and Sing on later. But sitting with me now, Annie Get Your Gun, January 25th, running through February 17th. And that's Friday and Saturday at 8 p.m. Special Sunday matinees always at 3 p.m. And we're doing a couple of student field trips.
We hope so.
We hope. We're not quite sure about that. Those would be like 10 o'clock in the morning. It's not for the general public. It's for high schools, middle schools, elementary schools. We felt that Annie Get Your Gun has got a lot of noteworthy things in it. It's American history. It's about the women's movement. It's about show business. It's about guns. I mean, how much more American can you get? So Annie Get Your Gun, playing January 25th, February 17th. 845-876-3080 to order tickets Tuesday through Saturday between the hours of 1 p.m. and 5 p.m. or online www.centerforperformingarts.org. So Andy, so you had the Rhinebeck Theater Society and you were being kicked around from pillar to post.
We were being kicked around. We were an itinerant group.
Itinerant.
Itinerant. We went from the town hall to a church to churchyard. We popped all over the place.
You were in the industrial park for a while.
We were in the industrial park in Rhinebeck. We were in the Morton Library.
When I first got involved, that's where you were. You were at the Morton Library probably the longest you were anywhere.
Yeah, we were there for a long time.
Long time.
Yeah. And we decided we needed to build a theater here.
Right.
And so a few of us said, let's form the Center for Performing Arts.
Which became another organization. So there was the Rhinebeck Theater Society.
Right.
And then it became the Rhinebeck Performing Arts Incorporated. It became another organization.
That's right. Because the Rhinebeck Theater Society would not have been able to maintain a facility like this year round. They did two or three productions a year, and that was it.
How much does this cost a year? About $112 a year? I mean, that's a lot of money. How much does it cost to run this theater?
It costs about $1,000 a day.
It's actually more than that if you do productions. If you add productions.
If you add productions in, it's more than that.
It's about 600, I think this year's budget is $675,000. That's a lot of money.
That's a lot of money.
Yeah.
Sounds like you could use some members.
But we could use a lot of members. If you want to become a member, you can join up. You can send Kevin Archambault your check. You send that to RPA Inc., 661 Route 308, Rhinebeck, New York, 12572. We welcome members. We need members. Members are the lifeblood because, as we've discussed many times, even if we sold out every show, we have 165 seats. If we sold out every show, every night, we'd still be short, about $200,000 a year.
That's right.
It's a lot of money. So you formed the Rhinebeck Performing Arts, but you didn't build this building right away.
No. We in 1993 we bought the land, and we set up a tent, and we operated in a tent every summer for 4 years, doing shows in the tent from July through August.
Yep.
Finished on Labor Day, took the tent down, packed it away. Next spring, put it up again. It was a job.
4 years.
4 years in a row, during which time we raised enough money to build this facility.
Super, super. And this building opened July 1, 1998.
That's correct.
So it's how many years now? I mean, how are you math?
Too much math for me.
How are you math? It's almost 15 years, right?
That's right.
It's almost 15
years. It'll be 15 years next July.
July of 2013.
That's right.
So Dean, you weren't with us then.
No.
Were you living in Dutchess County then?
I was not. I was living back in the city then.
The city? Which city?
New York City.
New York City, which is far away from where we are right now.
It's pretty far away.
Did you ever play in the tent when we were in the tent?
No, I didn't. But it was shortly after the building opened. 2000, I think, was the first play I did here.
I met you. You were how old?
Probably 12.
You were 12 years old when I first met Kate. She was in my acting class in the summer, right? That's right. First time I met Kate. And your mom, I met your mom at the same time, and your mom became, I think, our second director of education, and Charlene was in shows. She was fabulous.
She founded the Kids on Stage.
She founded the Kids on Stage program. Steel Magnolias. She was Truvy.
Right.
She played Truvy. Yeah. She was just superb. And she directed the first time we did Annie.
That's right.
Which is the show that we're doing in January of 2015.
No!
The sun will come out
Annie
tomorrow.
Annie, get your gun.
All right, so Annie, so we built this place. It opened in 1998. We have performed to about, we're averaging about 20,000 people a year. So I guess we're almost at 300,000 satisfied customers. Satisfied. I emphasize the word satisfied customers. Right?
Right.
Yeah, and a lot of them are members.
They are.
Yeah. And we have
not enough of them.
Not enough of members. And what plans do we have for the future? I mean, is this it? This is what it's going to be? And we have 165 seats. We just, we got hit really hard with Hurricane Irene.
Yes.
And we had to redo the entire basement. And now we have two really wonderful rooms, a nice studio, a nice classroom, green room, two wonderful dressing rooms. We did the costume room. We have our own costume collection. And what else is going on down there? I mean, what happens?
Well, we have our education program focused down there.
Right.
And we hope to expand someday.
Yeah, become bigger and better.
Bigger and better.
Do you think that people, in these trying economic times, people want more theater? I mean, do you think they do?
They always did.
Yeah.
The 1930s and big year, big time for theater.
During the Great Depression.
Yes.
Yes, big theater.
Theater,
the WPA,
movies,
Busby Berkeley, keep them happy. Everybody's smiling, smiling. Pack up your troubles. So, Kate, you just finished becoming, are you in the union yet?
No.
But you just finished this big scene design painting program.
I've been freelancing as a scenic artist and have been hired in professional studios, but got started painting here.
Painting here. Did you paint this floor?
Don't look at the floor.
Did you paint the floor?
Yeah,
you painted
that
barn?
That.
Oh, man, she paints everything. And so what's going to happen with that and you? I mean, you're going to look for like a big painting job and leave us?
Well, there's, I don't know if I, but there is more work in other areas.
Well, not here. I mean, you know, this is, it's this theater and Cocoon Theater in Rhinebeck, and where else do you go? Then you go to Poughkeepsie, you've got some theaters in Poughkeepsie.
This is my
Woodstock, this is your home base. And your big mentor was our good friend Richard Prowse.
Yes.
Richard Prowse, who has painted a bazillion different sets and drops. And did you learn a lot from Richard?
Oh, absolutely. He taught me pretty much everything I know.
Everything you know.
Scenic art.
Yeah. Yeah, he's an incredibly brilliant guy. Makes dolls, makes clothing, paints portraits, paints sets.
He's actually painting some stuff for the show, too.
That's right.
For which show?
For Annie Get Your Gun.
What is he painting?
He's painting our portraits.
Painting our posters.
And which one is bigger?
Well, again, that hasn't been settled yet because I haven't seen the final product.
You haven't seen the final product. Do you have a poster of yourself in this show?
No, I do not.
All right, so you're directing this show, and you must have musical directors for this show.
We have two musical directors.
Who's that?
Paul and Joanne Schubert, who
yes.
have directed so many shows, I can't even count them.
Well, they were with you in the tent, weren't they?
They were with us before the tent.
Before
they were
the tent.
With us in the Morton Library. Actually, the first show we did with them... We did at what is now the Terrapin Restaurant.
It used to
be Jack Russo's.
Yeah.
And we did a little review in their room there.
Aces Wild, Deuces Wild.
Deuces Wild,
Deuces
that's
Wild.
Right.
Yeah.
That was the first show they did with us.
Joanne is sitting out here, by the way. You're going to see her later. She's going to play the banjo when they do their song, right? It's Wild West theme. So Paul and Joanne Schubert are musical directors.
That's correct.
And you have a choreographer?
Yes, we have a very new, young choreographer, Leanne Kowalski. This is the first musical she's ever choreographed, and I think she's doing a wonderful job.
I've seen some of what she's done. It's really great. I mean, Leanne came to us because she was very involved in dancing for the center.
Right.
Last, what was it, April? It was a benefit for the center. Elaine Calandrea, who's probably the Madonna of dance in Rhinebeck. She's the woman. Just as Andy started theater, community theater in Rhinebeck, Elaine is probably the person who's most instrumental. Dance in Rhinebeck. Well, Abby Saxon, and now Leanne. And Leanne is our choreographer. And that, again, we're talking about Annie Get Your Gun. And that opens on January 25th, closes on February 17th. You have to make, we have to make reservations.
Oh, absolutely.
If you don't make reservations for
this
show, you are not going to get in. You'll have to come in at gunpoint if you don't make a reservation. It'll be like, you know, robbing the train.
Wells Fargo,
the great train robbery. You're going to have to rob your way into the Center for Performing Arts. 845-876-3080. And that's how you get tickets Tuesday through Saturday between the hours of 1 p.m. 5 p.m., and you guys are going to do a number. Anything else you want to say about the Center for Performing Arts, getting people to become more involved? I mean, we always have opportunities, right? We need everybody.
We need lots of volunteers.
Yep.
We need new actors, and
yep.
We need new dancers.
Because we're tired of Kate, Dean.
We're tired of
her. I've had it with Kate. That's it. Since she's 12. How old are you now? You don't have
to. I just said I'm 26.
You're 26? So we've known you for 14 years? It seems like only yesterday, literally. So we need actors.
We need everybody.
We need painters.
We need painters. We need costumers.
We need people in the technical area.
We need tech people.
Lighting people.
Sound designers.
People to run the fly system.
Carpenters.
Yes. You know what? Everybody thinks that when you go to the theater and you see the actors come out and they do the show and the set is behind them and they're wearing costumes. Well, how easy is that? Right? So literally, there are like three people for every one actor when you put it all together. Building, painting.
Yes.
I mean, it's really something else. Dean, do you do work other than being an actor?
Other than act, yes.
Yeah. What do you do?
I'm a creative director for a design firm in Millbrook.
Yes, designing what?
And one of the things we design actually is theatrical projection.
Theatrical projection.
So theater, it's an ongoing theme.
Ooh, we should talk after the
show.
We
should talk.
We have talked before.
Yeah. You've done our website too, right?
I did your website.
He did our website. www.centerforperformingarts.org stands for Wild West Web. All right, so we're going to take a, there's going to be like, you know, a black screen just for a moment. And don't think you've passed that. No, there's not. She's shaking her head. There's not going to be a black. Because this is the modern era. And this is not like the old days of television. So we're going to do, we're going to jump from here. And we're going to be in front of the piano. And Wild Kate and Wild Dean are going to sing a song from Annie. And maybe
Annie, get your gun.
Sorry, Annie, get your gun. All right, so thanks. We'll be right back.
Anything you can do, I can do better.
Ha!
I can do anything better than you.
No, you can't.
Yes, I can.
No, you can't.
Yes, I can.
No, you can't.
Yes, I can. Yes, I can.
Anything you could be, I can be greater. Sooner or later, I'm greater than you.
You're not.
Yes, I am.
You're not.
Yes, I am.
You're not.
Yes, I am. Yes, I am. I can shoot a partridge with a single cartridge.
I can hit a sparrow with a bow and arrow.
I can live on bread and cheese.
And only on that?
Yes.
How can a rat?
Any note you can sing, I can sing higher.
I can sing any note higher than you.
No, you can't.
Yes, I can.
No, you can't.
Yes, I can.
No, you can't.
Yes, I can.
No, you can't.
Oh, yes, I can. Cheaper, I can buy anything cheaper than you.
50 cents.
40 cents.
30 cents.
20 cents.
No, you can't.
Yes, I can. Yes, I can.
Anything you can say, I can say softer.
I can say anything softer than you.
No, you can't.
Yes, I can.
Drink my liquor faster than a flicker.
I can drink it quicker and get even sicker.
I can open any safe
without being caught.
Sure.
That's what I thought you'd look.
Any note you can hold, I can hold longer.
I can hold any note longer than you.
No, you can't.
Yes, I can.
No, you can't.
Yes, I can.
No, you can't.
Yes, I can. Yes, I can.
Tickets, you call 845-876-3085. Zero, Tuesday through Sunday, between the hours of 1 p.m. and 5 p.m. You also go online, www.centerforperformingarts.org. And we told you, www stands for Wild West Web. And there are other shows happening in January. And now that we have survived the Mayan apocalypse, and I'm so glad because I was actually very worried. But all for naught. I was
terrified.
I was prepared.
See the back of his car.
See the back of my car. Yes, I'm prepping for something. It's just, I don't know what. But we have other shows happening in January. Other Wild West shows. Awake and Sing by Wild Bill Clifford Odets. And sitting to my right is Wild Emily Depew, who is the assistant director for this show. Is that right?
That's correct.
That's correct. You're not in this show.
No.
And Kevin Archambeau, Wild Kevin Archambeau.
Just Wild
Kevin, who is also in this show.
Yes, indeed.
And Kevin is also the director of community and public relations here at the Center for Performing Arts. He is responsible for getting these out. A new one is coming out on what, did you say?
January 10th.
January 10th. It's mailed to how many people?
About 15,000.
That's a lot of people.
I hand deliver them.
He does.
He
has a horse thing. He gets on the horse.
And a little bell.
And a little bell. And he delivers these. And also these go to hotels.
And bed and breakfast.
Restaurants and saloons.
Yes.
And mine shafts. Stagecoach routes. You can get this and you can do special things with this.
Absolutely.
All right, so Awake and Sing. No, let's talk. Awake and Sing opens before the Elephant Man, right? Elephant Man is second. Elephant Man, actually, Awake and Sing is only three nights, January 4, 5, and 6. That's a Friday, a Saturday, and a Sunday matinee. And that's in January 4, 5, and 6. And then Elephant Man opens immediately thereafter, January 11, and runs through January 20th. So let's kind of deal with this sequentially. I don't know why, because it sounds like a good idea. So Awake and Sing is about, what is this about, Emily?
It's about a family in the 1930s, during the Depression, and how they cope, and how they strive.
Cope with what? Cope with poverty.
Yes, with poverty and have dreams that they really want to chase and go after, but, you know, life gets in the way. Handle that situation.
Poverty gets in the way.
The Great Depression. None of you none of us are old enough to remember the Great Depression. We were all born after the Great Depression.
Well after
the Great Depression.
Just barely.
Yeah, I know. He's been nipping and tucking as time goes by. So, and who are you in this play now, Awake and Sing?
I play the son, Ralph.
Ralph. Yes. Ralph Berger.
Ralph Berger.
Yeah, and what's with Ralph? What does Ralph do for a living?
He works in a factory.
Yeah, doing what?
I believe
Clothing. He's in the garment industry. Schmatas. He's a garmento. He's a garmento in Midtown New York. And he has an uncle who's a big schmata guy.
Played by somebody I know.
Somebody, I don't know who. There's only nine people. You met three of those people before, not including me. Here are another three people. So you're Ralph Berger.
I am.
And so you are striving, as Emily said, trying to cope. And what happens to you during this play?
Not a thing.
There's not very much happy in this play.
There's not, but you know, it's really important. The whole family is struggling. The mother, played by Marlene Golda, I should probably learn how to say her name.
That's right. She is on the board of directors.
I should know how to say
her name. You will get a memo.
There's only one letter shy.
He's only one letter shy. He put that in I. There is no I in Golia. So,
she plays my mother, she's trying to hold the family together.
Right.
You play her brother.
I read the rich uncle. The clothing manufacturer.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And her keeping us all together is actually impaling us. Really, it's really hurting us with her trying to hold everything so tight.
Right. So it's kind of like your love, but you're kind of getting smothered.
Smothered.
So
indeed.
You have a sister in this play.
I do, played by Nikki Smith.
Nikki Smith and.
She ends up pregnant.
Oh, no. In the 30s?
In the 30s. That happens.
Gee. I thought that only happened, like, in this millennium.
Yeah, me too.
Yeah.
I guess we're
So, right. And now you didn't direct this play. You're the assistant
I did
director.
Not. I'm assisting Tom.
He couldn't be with us today. What is he doing? He's been doing something today.
I don't know.
He's seeing his mom.
No, is he seeing his mom yet? Oh, no. I thought he had like a singing engagement.
Sometimes he has singing engagements.
Tom's been in lots of shows.
He has.
One with all of us, actually.
Yes, actually.
What was that?
The Glass Menagerie.
Which we did a year ago
during the flood.
During the flood.
At Katzbahn.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's right. And you were in that.
I was Laura.
Laura, and you were in that.
Tom.
Evan. And you were in that.
I was Amanda.
And Thomas was in that.
Gentleman Caller.
And Paul Schubert wrote a wonderful score for that.
Beautiful score.
Really beautiful. It was a fabulous production. Mm-hmm. So, Kevin, you're also...
You directed it.
I did. Again, one of nine people we meet as Andy, Wild Bill Andy Weintraub said to him during his plea for people. You know...
If we could have ten.
Just ten.
We make all the difference. Although 11's a master number.
So, this is Clifford Odets, great playwright of the 30s, wrote also Golden Boy.
It's on Broadway right now.
Which is on Broadway right now.
Dog at the Top of the Stairs.
No, that's Inch.
Oh, that he wrote that...
Waiting for Lefty.
The big labor play. Yeah, the group theater. I mean, if it hadn't been for his scripts, the group theater wouldn't have taken off. Harold Clurman and the Adlers, Morris Konofsky, and John Garfield. Edward G. Robinson, they were all the mainstay of the group. So you're the assistant director, so what does that mean? Do you like go out for coffee and stuff?
I try not to.
What do you do? What does the assistant director do?
I assist the director.
Well, that's it's self-explanatory.
I help Thomas so that he doesn't have a nervous breakdown.
Is he stressed about this play?
He gets a little nervous.
This is the first thing he's directed here, right?
Here, yes. But he does have directing credit.
Yeah, so the assistant director does what then?
Actually, I've been taking down blocking, but usually the stage manager does.
But we don't have a stage manager for this show.
Yeah, so I'm like AD/SM.
AD stands for
Assistant Director.
/SM.
Yes.
Stage manager. Mm-hmm. Cool. And
it's like
WWW. Wild West Web. ADSM. It should be in the diagnostic manual.
I believe it is.
ADSM.
I have ADSM.
And I'm taking Ritalin and 1,000 other drugs to get better.
I just drink.
You just drink. Yeah. All right. So, Kevin, so you're in this show, but you're doing something else that I think Emily is involved with, and that's what? You're directing a show coming up.
I am, but that doesn't happen until March. Many months away.
Many months.
Spring Awakening,
which is about what?
Teenage angst.
Teenage
coming of age story.
In the modern era in America?
It's set in Germany, actually, in the 19th century. Late 19th century.
Yeah.
But the music is very modern and rock.
Right.
So it's kind of got a juxtaposition that way.
And you're directing and choreographing.
I am.
And Emily's in this show.
She is.
Yeah. Is Lisa in this show?
She's not in this
show. But Lisa, we have to now move on to you. So the Elephant Man. So I remember this. This was a 1940 movie with Lon Chaney. And when the moon came out, he turned into an elephant.
That was the Wolf Man.
Oh, the Wolf Man. Yeah.
But I understand why you would.
Why I would think that. So what is the Elephant Man about exactly?
It's actually the real life story of an unfortunate, severely deformed man named John Merrick. His actual name is Joseph Merrick, but everybody knows him as John Merrick. Who is maligned and carted around by a circus barker named Ross. He lives in workhouses. He was abandoned very, very young as a child because of his severe deformities. And of course, we can barely deal with the disabled, properly
today.
Back then it was absolutely unspeakable.
Well, they treated him like a circus freak.
People made money off of him. They absolutely did. Ross charged for his appearance, so people would pay however many shillings in Victorian England. But
as it turns out in this play, we discover that mentally, he's almost a genius.
Yes, right. He's very erudite. He's really he's incredibly well read.
Yes,
he's incredibly sensitive. Of course, people equate the fact that he looked the way he did with mental incapacity, which was not the case, of course. He's eventually discovered by a doctor of anatomy, Dr. Frederick Treves, who brings him to the London Hospital. And there he enormous, enormous donations made through various pleas through the head of the hospital and through the London Times. And he becomes really the toast of the town. And interestingly enough, by making him normal, that almost becomes his undoing.
And this has a musical score by whom?
Me.
Yeah. This is not a musical.
No, it's not.
Not a musical.
It's a screenplay.
Yeah, everybody thinks
well,
that, you
won
know,
the Tony.
Yeah, it did win a Tony.
It won the Tony
the
for
Tony.
Best Play.
Yeah, and it's been made into a very successful film. And we'll talk about that in a second, the differences between the film and the play. But, you know, people think that at the Center for Performing Arts, because the things that they remember are the things like Cats and Hairspray and Legally Blonde, and I'm sure they're going to remember Annie Get Your Gun. White Christmas was played last month, which you could not get into unless you stuck up the guy at the box office. But we do more than that. I mean, we do dramas,
mm-hmm.
we do comedies,
Shakespeare,
we do things without music. We're doing our first George Bernard Shaw. We haven't done a Shaw play here at the Center, and we're
Season
doing
Cleopatra.
Season of Cleopatra in April as part of the Shakespeare Festival, followed by Julius Caesar. So what am I talking about? So this was a Brooks Films. Mel Brooks produced this movie. And actually took it, he didn't take the play. He took the story, but it had a lot of elements from the play. And he made a very successful film with
David Lynch directed.
David Lynch and John Hurt played.
John Hurt played.
And
Anthony Hopkins played.
Anthony Hopkins played Treat. But in the movie, they actually had him in makeup so that he looked like the real Merrick.
Correct.
But in your stage production, and the wonderful thing about Bernard Pomerantz's play, he looks just like anybody else, right?
Yes.
He's not deformed.
No. In fact, in Dr. Treves' first lecture to his anatomy class, as he is describing all of the terrible infirmities and deformities that Merrick possesses, the actor playing Merrick physically adopts these maladies, these deformities,
right.
And then has to maintain it throughout the
But there's no grotesque, there's no
Nothing
mask,
whatsoever.
There's no
none
special stage makeup, none of that. None of that. Because the real Joseph Merrick, when you looked upon him, it was quite startling.
Well, and you will see that we will be using
You'll see the slides
of
him.
His actual
right.
appearance.
Right. Now, you've directed other things. This is not your first director.
No, it's not. Not my first time at this
Not
company.
First time at the trial.
No, let's see.
We just finished Kids on Stage.
Oh, yes, I've done 16 Kids on Stage 16, productions.
Wow.
That's next month. It's right back. Beauty and the Beast this summer. Story in the Theater has just passed.
Story Theater was in December.
Beauty and the Beast was in August.
Right.
The last thing I directed main stage, meaning evening adults, was Dracula. I directed the Rocky Horror Show. I directed Side by Side by Sondheim, Psycho Beach Party, a few things.
Lots of stuff, and you're in lots of plays.
I am in a lot of plays, yep.
All right, so let me ask. So, Emily, I understand Andy was talking about that we were a tent many years ago before
Where
this was a building. You, none of you performed in the tent. You didn't perform in the tent.
No, I
you
came shortly after
tent.
You.
Nope.
I was in the tent in two things, I believe, and you were in the tent in something.
I was in the tent, but even before that, I was in the business building.
The industrial park.
The industrial park.
What play did you do there?
My first community theater show was The King and I. Andy Weintraub was the king. My best friend and I.
Wow.
We're wives. I was
what
12.
Year was that? What year was that?
Ooh. God, it was in the 80s.
1989
in the industrial park. So there, you didn't even have the land. I'm talking to Andy who's off camera. You didn't even have the land for this yet.
That's correct.
That's right. So you were in that. How old were you?
I was 12.
12?
Playing a wife?
Yeah.
It was legal in
Siam. In Siam in the 19th century. Oh, the good old days.
And I also performed at the Mormon Library.
Yeah, what did you do there?
I did a show. That's where I met you.
What show was that?
The Importance of Being Earnest.
By Oscar Wilde.
Yes.
Oh, and
Cecily.
Cecily.
Yes.
And then you were also in something else in the tent, big musical.
Yes, Little Night Music. Andy was also in that.
Andy was the Baron, I think, right? You were the Baron in that?
I was Carl Frederick.
Okay. Big
Barbara
show.
Rankin played
and Paul
my
and
mother.
Joanne Schubert were the musical directors for that.
Yes.
And that was in the tent. So, Kevin, you weren't in the tent. Lisa wasn't in the tent. I did one or two things in the tent. You were like a zillion years ago.
Yes.
And so, yeah, just yesterday.
And just yesterday. So, Kevin, what else is going on here? What wearing your director of community public relations hat? What are we up to? And that is the hat that he wears as the director of community public relations.
Come by upstairs.
When he directs, he wears this hat. And when he's acting, he wears that hat.
Exactly.
So, what's going on? Are we doing anything now?
Not a thing.
Nothing? Well, thank you, ladies and gentlemen.
No, we're always busy trying to get more members. We just you just probably received a letter from us, hopefully, if you're on our mailing list for our year-end letter, thanking you for being part of the center. And then kicking off the brochure that you'll be getting January 10th, speaking of this lovely brochure.
Lovely brochure. This is the one that's out right now.
Just in time for the inauguration.
Yes, in fact, I'm glad you mentioned that, because President Wild Bill Obama, we are going to be papering the Oval Office with our new brochure. We've been invited to send 10,000 of these brochures. They're going to be all over the Oval Office. I understand that Susan Rice, who's no longer going to be nominated as Secretary of State, but John Kerry called me this morning.
He did.
Be a child like that with buds. He said, if I'm Secretary of State, Lou, the Oval Office, nothing but center brochures. So, Awake and Sing opens on January 4th, three nights, the 4th, the 5th, and the 6th, Friday and Saturday, 8 p.m., Sunday, 3 p.m., you call. That's very important. So, what is the difference between a reading, a staged reading, and a real performance?
In a reading, the actors hold their scripts.
Right.
And they're usually seated.
Right.
In a line or semicircle.
Or can they can stand behind a music stand?
Yes, they can use a music stand.
No movement.
No movement.
No set.
No set.
Okay.
In a staged reading,
which is what we're doing,
the actors do move,
right,
as in a full production,
right,
but they still have their script.
They still hold their books, but there's more acting involved.
Yes.
And there's actually furniture.
Yeah,
and set. Yeah, full set.
And this play has been blocked. I mean, Thomas actually blocked
the
play. All right, so that's the 4th, 5th, and the 6th of January. And again, 845-876-3080. Tuesday through Saturday, between the hours of 1 p.m., 5 p.m., www.centerforperformingarts.org. And immediately after that closes, we come up with The Elephant Man, January 11th through January 20th. And again, Fridays and Saturdays, 8 p.m., Sunday, 3 p.m., same phone number, 876-3080. And then the week after Elephant Man closes, we open with Annie, Get Your Gun, directed by Wild Bill, Andy Weintraub, opening on January 25, runs to February 17, and you saw a number from that. Anything you can do, I can do better. So, Emily, you were also working on other things. You're going to be assisting the Shakespeare camp that Diana DeGrande is going to do.
I am, yes.
Yeah, and
I've been touring.
With the touring company, Rip Van Winkle.
Rip Van Winkle, been going to local schools with two other performers, putting up a play that you wrote.
That I wrote. Nine people! And we need playwrights desperately.
And that's about Rip Van Winkle.
Rip Van Winkle. And we're going to actually be performing that at the Washington Irving Estate, Sunnyside.
Yes, the actual estate.
The actual estate. We got invited to do that. Yes, it's a national landmark. The Irving Estate is a national landmark. And we're going to be there. And Kevin, you've got Spring Awakening coming up.
I do Spring Awakening.
And then you have something else after that that you're slated to do.
Jekyll and Hyde.
Wow.
I know.
Boy, we're into this Victorian, scary,
foolish
thing. You did Dracula last year, and now you're doing The Elephant Man, and you're doing Dr. Jekyll. It's called Jekyll and Hyde.
Just Jekyll and
Jekyll
Hyde.
Jekyll and Hyde. And it's a musical.
It's a musical.
It's a musical.
Frank Wildwood.
Who is it?
Frank Wildwood. Also Wild.
Wild? Is it scary?
It is. It does have a lot of terror to it.
Yes? Yeah, it's a scary story. I remember I read that when I was about 10 years old. It was a summer evening. I'd walked to the library in Northport, and I'd come home, and I guess about 9 o'clock at night, all the windows open with the crickets and the wolves howling and the coyotes. I was reading this. It scared the bejesus out of me.
It's not that scary. It's a family show.
It is a family show. I'm sorry. I take all that back. It's not frightening.
You were 10.
I was 10.
Yeah.
What scares you when you're 10 is not the same thing that scares you when you're, now it's taxes and Medicare and things like that.
Oh, good grief.
So again, ladies and gentlemen, this brochure, a new one, coming out January 10th. Lisa Lentz, who just finished doing Kids on Stage Story Theater. You're right. He's going to be doing The Element Man. And are you in anything coming up? You've been cast in anything?
I actually haven't auditioned for anything. The last thing I did was Threepenny Opera.
Threepenny Opera. You were
Jenny
Diver.
Jenny Diver.
And Andy produced and built that show.
He did.
Yeah, and you're doing Rip, and you're assistant director. The other touring company, by the way. Not only is it Rip Van Winkle, but it's also Selected Tales by Edgar Allan Poe, and you're doing that. High schools, middle schools, yes. The look of terror just went across her eyes. It's a hell of a script to learn, believe me.
Yeah.
All of them are very different.
Yes, The Raven, Telltale Heart, and Cask of Amontillado.
Cask of Amontillado, very interesting. And we're working on, the Irving guys. We're going to talk to the Irving guys about doing a Headless Horseman. And then we're going to do a Scarlet A, which is the Scarlet Letter.
Ooh.
So this is a very successful little enterprise, by the way. The wellspring of it is, of course, it costs $111 million to drive a school bus here for kids to see a show. They only pay $8 a ticket. It's cheaper than a movie. Mm-hmm. But the bus. So we said, well, let's get rid of the bus issue. We'll go to you. So we've been going to schools. So once again, before we go away, 845-876-3080, Tuesday through Saturday, between the hours of 1 p.m., 5 p.m., WWW Center for Performing Arts. Please come see Awake and Sing, January 4th, 5th, and 6th. Please, The Elephant Man, January 11th through 20th, right here on the stage. And, you know, we do so few dramas during the year. I mean, maybe we do 3 out of, 25 shows we do. Maybe there's 3 dramas, 4 dramas. And then please come and see Annie Get Your Gun, January 25th through February 17th. So this has been Wild West Month here at the Center for Performing Arts. Thank you so much. Adios.
Like show business, like no business I know. Everything about it is appealing, everything the traffic will allow. Nowhere could you get that happy feeling when you are stealing that extra bow. There's no people like show people. They smile when they are low. Yesterday they told you you would not. Scenery, the makeup, the props, the audience that lifts you when you're down. The headaches, the heartaches, the backaches, the flops, the sheriff who escorts you out of town. The opening when your heart beats like a drum. The closing when the customers don't come. Get word before the show has started that your favorite uncle died at dawn. On top of that, your pa and I have parted. You're brokenhearted, but you go on. There's no people like show people. They smile when they are low. Even with a turkey that you know.